good to see you in this wonderful Sunday morning. You see, I changed the scenery and I'm outside my house in my backyard. I wanted to do something different this time in this beautiful Sunday. As you know, this is Pentecost Sunday. So the words from the Word of God that I have to you relate to our Pentecost celebration. And let's have a word of prayer. This beautiful day and for the things that you provide for us every day. And as we focus on you this morning, we ask you, Father, that you help us to remember that wonderful day where you empower the church, where you empower the believers for them to fulfill the Great Commission of preaching the gospel. I ask you, Father, that you will be with us as we experience your word at this very moment. In your name we pray. Amen. I have a question for you. Are you ready for Pentecost? Are you ready to experience Pentecost? You know, I want to read from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 to 11. And this is what the Word of God says. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proof that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will baptize with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. For you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand before looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." May the Lord bless his word. So, today is Pentecost Sunday. And it is chapter 2, the one that relates that story. And I'm going to share that with you too. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enables them. Do you know what Pentecost word means? It means 50, and that's the Greek word. The Hebrew word for Pentecost is Shabbat, and I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right, but Shabbat means weeks, and it refers to the Jewish feast of weeks. But there are two big events that happen in Jewish history during that feast of weeks. One that happened 1500 years before Pentecost, you know, when the Spirit came to the disciples. And that event was the giving of the Ten Commandments. And if you remember the story, God gave the Ten Commandments to Moses, and the Bible said that he wrote in tablets of stones the Ten Commandments. Now, the second event is this one in chapter 2 of Acts, which is when God, we could say that God writes His law, not in stones, but in their hearts. You know, in a much deeper fashion, God wrote in the hearts of men. So in Pentecost, Jesus promised in chapter 1 and in other parts of scriptures were fulfilled. You know, we can see it in John 14, 6 to 17, and verse 26 also of the same chapter. He says, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you." And verse 26 says, "But the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you." Also in John chapter 15, verse 26, it says this, "When the advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth goes out from the Father. He will testify about me." So Pentecost, that experience of 10 Pentecost of chapter 2 was the fulfillment of Jesus' promise. Jesus was taken from them physically, but then the presence of God descended upon them in this day of Pentecost. Now, I was thinking about an experience that I had many years ago when I was stationed in the Empire State Division, and I had to help the officers from the Amsterdam Corps. We helped them to get a new quarters for the corps officers. And the day came when they were gonna start to build this place. But the thing that's, the house was prefabricated. But when I went to the court to see what the construction company was doing, they were laying a foundation. They were laying what they needed to put the prefabricated house on top of it. So laying down a nice foundation before they put the prefabricated house was extremely important. And I think all contractors know that. It is very important to have a house on a firm foundation. I read this pastor, Jeffrey Sims, he wrote about his experience, a similar experience. He said, "When I built our house, the foundation was built very differently than what it is the norm for around Mississippi. My uncle, who had built houses in the mountains of Colorado, built my foundation. First, we took the soil down to virgin dirt, then dug some footers and filled them with rebar and turned some of the rebar up. We poured the footers and then a couple of days later came back and added some horizontal rebar at the rebar that was turned up and formed for an 8-inch concrete wall. After that, we filled with dirt and compacted it, called in the plumber, and after he finished, we laid down a moisture barrier rebar and wire, then poured the slab. Lots of steel, wire, concrete, and sweat went into the foundation of our house, but we knew that we needed that before the framework could ever begin. I wonder, should we lay a foundation before the experience of Pentecost in our lives?" You know, when we look at the early church, we could see how the apostles changed from a fearful followers to a fearless apostles. And usually we think and we say that the experience of Pentecost was the thing that changed their lives completely. And that is true. But the thing is that for them to have that experience of Pentecost, a foundation had to be laid down. You know, we cannot experience Pentecost if we don't fully grasp what needs to happen before we have that experience. You know, chapter 1 of the book of Acts that we read, it tells us what happened between the resurrection and Pentecost. Because there's where the foundation lies. We also need to realize that what happened to the disciples can still happen to you and to me today. The lost can be found. Miracles can happen. And we can become effective when we come to experience the power of Pentecost in our lives today. But the foundation needs to be laid down for us to experience that. And how do we do that? How do we lay a firm foundation in our lives and in our church for the Holy Spirit to build upon that? Well, I have a few points that I want to share with you. First is, we must become convinced of the presence of Jesus in our lives. You know, the disciples were sure that Jesus had overcome death. They were sure about the resurrected Jesus. And Jesus appeared to them in small groups, in large groups. And the Bible tells us at least 10 times following his death and burial, Jesus appeared to them. He talked to them and ate with them and assured them of his presence. They were convinced that Jesus lived. And not just that, he was always in their midst. Are you convinced of the resurrection of the Lord? Is he always with you? Are you experiencing Christ? You know, we need to grasp that concept that Jesus is alive and he is with us. He is walking with us. He is involved in our lives. You know, some people just say it, but we need to believe it. We need to experience it in our lives. So we must grab that reality of the living Jesus constantly in our lives. And that's the first thing that we need to lay down to experience Pentecost. The second thing is that we must realize that Jesus is not finished with us yet. We accepted him as our Savior, and there's a work to be done in us, and we must be willing to submit to that process. What did the disciples do? The disciples, the scripture tells us that they joined together in prayer and fellowship, waiting on the promised power, waiting on Pentecost to happen. Why? Because they believed in Jesus, and they knew that Jesus was involved and was in their lives. They realized that when the power came, it would be not the end, but the beginning of something great that was going to happen. You know, they have done a lot of work with Jesus through the 3 years of ministry with him, but there was more to come. So, first, we must become convinced of the presence of Jesus, and we must realize that Jesus is not finished with us. And the third thing, we must realize that we can receive the same power the disciples have. Luke chapter 10, verse 19 to 20 says, I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the powers of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the Spirit submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. And then in Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20, it says, then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, to Jesus. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Jesus at one time was with them, then he left, then later he was in them through the Holy Spirit. And that can happen. We need to realize that that can happen in your life and in my life. We must realize that we have work to do. Not in our own strength, but in the strength that Christ gives us. Because he has given all authority, and now he is in us. Now we have all authority to do the work of God on this earth. Someone said, he does not call the equipped, he equipped the call. You know how many times I don't feel capable of many things that the Lord asked me to do through the ministry of the Salvation Army. But why do I do it? I just trust God that he told me that he will give me the power to do what it needs to be done. And that's how I move forward, knowing that the power of God is working in me. So for that to happen, we need to be conscious that he still works. He's still working in you, and he's still working in me. The other point that I wanted to make is that we need to be strengthening each other. What did Jesus tell the believers? Jesus told the disciples to stay together and wait for the power. And what did they do? They band together, they prayed, they talk about and ponder all that had happened in their lives, and they waited. We need fellowship. We need to pray and lift each other up. Now, during this time of the pandemic, during this time of our turmoil in our country, for the things that we have seen, now we need to pray and we need to fellowship with each other. If we cannot be together physically, but we can be together by these means, by Zoom and other ways that we are experiencing now. We need to encourage each other and work together for the good of the kingdom of God. Not for our own good, but for the good of the kingdom of God, for the things and the work that needs to be done. Those are the foundations that we need to lay if we want to see and feel an outpouring of the power of Pentecost, the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Three, we must be willing to wait. We touched a little bit on that before. You know, I was thinking about that. You know, we live in an instantaneous world. We have microwaves, we have cell phones. Having the new van that we have for the core, you have remote start vehicle. In the morning I wake up, when it was cold in the mornings, I could turn on the vehicle and let it warm up without having to go out. You know, we have a remote control televisions, and those are as old as me or older know that we didn't have that before. Why do we have all those advances? Well, we have to face it because we don't want to wait. We want things now. So we invent all these things that help us not to wait. But when we're dealing with God, we need to have patience. We have to be willing to wait because things are done in his time, and his time is best. How long did Jesus wait to start his ministry? Well, he started his ministry when he was 30 years old. 30 years old. We need to remember that we are not waiting on God to move, but we are waiting on God to make us ready to move. Sometimes we are called to wait on Pentecost, and that's when we begin to prepare ourselves for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit through prayer, through study of the Word, and through fellowship. That's what God is calling us to do, to pray, to study His Word, to have fellowship. That will lay the foundation for His Holy Spirit and His power to come and help us to do what we need to do. And what happens when it comes? When the time comes, we need to be open for this experience of Pentecost to happen to us, or happen to you. So when Pentecost comes, I'm sure, like it did in my life, it's gonna rock and shake your whole life. You know, we must walk knowing that sometimes It's not more knowledge that we need, but we need also commitment to Jesus. And that's what Jesus is asking from us. Now, recently, we lost pastor and apologist Rabbi Zachariah. I posted about this in my Facebook page, and I posted his memorial service that was done beautifully. And in this memorial service, they talk about his conversion and how being a guy from India with a Hindu background at the age of 17, after having tried to commit suicide and was laying in a hospital, his mother started to read the Bible to him. And through this experience, he accepted Jesus and committed himself to the Lord. And through this commitment, he was empowered by the Holy Spirit and started this big ministry that has helped many Christians around the world and have brought the gospel to many non-Christians, Muslims, Hindus, and people from other religions. In this ministry, they have answered many of the hard questions posed to Christianity in this modern world. I thank God for Rabbi Zachariah. But how was he empowered to do the work? How was God able to use him? Because he committed to Jesus, to the ministry, and the things that God wanted to do in him and through his life. So regardless of our past, we can become new creatures empowered by the Holy Spirit. But for Pentecost to happen to us, we must fully commit to the place God has planted us and fully commit to the task that he has set before us. So my question to you, do you want to experience Pentecost in your life? Are you committed to God? Is something holding you back? Pastor John MacArthur, he wrote an article called The Marks of the Committed Christians. And it's based on John 13, 31 to 38. And he talks about these marks of the committed Christian. He said, committed Christian has an unending preoccupation with the glory of God. So the committed Christian is preoccupied and absorbed with his glory, with the Lord's glory. The very purpose for which we exist is to give glory to God. So the committed Christian knows that his life is to give glory to God. The second thing that he listed was that a committed Christian has an unfailing love for the children of God. So he's saying that the committed Christian is filled with the love of God for those around him. And he said, perhaps this distinguishing mark of the committed Christian is the most significant of all in terms of practical living. And the third thing that he said is, a committed Christian has an unmovable loyalty to the Son of God. That's the third mark of the committed Christian, loyalty. Discipleship is more than a promised loyalty. It must go beyond making a vow to God. Discipleship demands practice loyalty. And we have talked a lot about this. It's called obedience. An operating, functioning kind of loyalty that holds up under every kind of pressure. And then Pastor MacArthur, he lists Matthew 16:22, and he said, this vividly shows how intensely Peter hated the thought of Jesus' impending death. And this is what happened. Jesus had foretold his crucifixion and resurrection, and Peter, always the self-appointed spokesman for the disciples, took Jesus aside and began to rebuke him. This was a stubborn, selfish attitude on the part of Peter, who did not want Jesus to be taken from him under any conditions. And then he says that Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are not setting your mind in God's interest, but man's. Sometimes that's what holds us back to experience Pentecost. we put our interests before God's interest. Are you committed to Christ? Are you willing to leave everything for Him? That was the foundation for the experience of Pentecost in the lives of the disciples and in the lives of many Christians around the world, in history, all the way through our days. Are you committed to God? Is something holding you back? That's the question you need to ask yourself today. Let's have a word of prayer. Let's have a prayer of commitment to our Lord. Let's bow our heads. Lord Jesus, help us to grow in the awareness that you and only you can sustain us. Help us to continuously increase in the recognition that only you can make us become what you want us to be. Help us to rest in your strength as we realize that we are weak. We pray that we may be completely committed to walk with you. We pray that we may be content as we serve you. We pray that we may not turn away from the path of righteousness for your name's sake. We pray that the devil will not have power to take us from your loving presence and from serving you. We pray that our reliance in you may grow deeper every day, and that our assurance in you may be bigger and wider. We pray that our faith in you may grow stronger and our zeal for you may grow bigger. We pray that we may continue to rely on your wisdom and we will no longer lean on our own understanding. We pray that we may yield to your instructions at all times and make you first in all we do. We ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Yeah!